Alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salam ala rasulillah ma ba'd. The question is asking about hijrah. I think there is a Muslim country somewhere that has opened up its doors and allowing for people to make hijrah and giving them, you know, the ability to establish a residence in their country. And I've actually been asked this question by a number of people. And one person even said that there is a person living in that country from their relatives, and they have said, it is now wajib for you to leave the West and come and join us in this country because you've got the opportunity to do so. So the questioner, this question is asking, what's the ruling on hijrah today for us living here in the West? Now, there are many ayat in the Quran. There are many ahadith which talk about hijrah. You will find it in Surah Al-Imran. You'll find it in Surah Al-Nisa. You'll find it in Surah Al-Anfal, you'll find it in Surah Tawbah, you'll find it in many places in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanding it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared a great reward for those people who establish it. Rizq and a promise and increase of rizq has been connected to hijrah. Success and victory and all these different other things have been established for those people who make the hijrah. But what is the ruling on hijrah? Now, when we talk about the ruling, the ulama have used this ayah from Surah An-Nisa to discuss the ruling on hijrah. And this is, you know, meaning the asl that they go to when it comes to the ruling on hijrah. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ تَوَفَّاهُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ ظَالِمِي أَنفُسِهِمْ. Surely the malaika, when they approach those people at the point of death who are ظَالِمِي أَنفُسِهِمْ, they are wronging themselves. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes them as wronging themselves. قَالُوا فِي مَا كُنْتُمْ. The malaika will then say to those people who are wronging themselves, how were you? قَالُوا كُنَّا مُسْتَدْعَفِينَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. They will say, we were weak in the land. Now, Sa'id ibn Jubayr, he says, إِذَا عُمِلَ بِالْمَعَاصِ. If sins and disobedience is being established for arb in a particular place where a person is, فَخْرُجْ مِنْهُ. Then he must leave that land. Now, this is important, because the ulama have said, your situation differs. Hijrah is not of one level. So here, are you weak in the land or are you not? This is the question. And then the ayat go on, قَالُوا أَلَمْ تَكُنْ عَنْدَ اللَّهِ وَاسِعَ فَتَهَاجِرُ فِيهَا. Then the malaika will put blame on them. Wasn't the land of Allah vast in order for you to then make hijrah and then leave the ma'asi? And that excuse will not be accepted from them. We also have a hadith on the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, مَنْ سَاكَنْ الْمُشْرِكْ وَجَامَأَهُ فَهُوَ مِثْلُهُ. Anyone who lives alongside the mushrik and he is mixing with them, then he is of them. In another hadith, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَنَا بَرِيءٌ مِّن مُسْلِمْ بَاتَ بَيْنَ ذَهْرَانَيْ الْمُشْرِكِينَ. I am completely cut off and disassociated with the Muslim who lives amongst the mushrikun and the kuffar. So using these kind of ayat, a person can then understand that hijrah is wajib. But the ulama have said, no, hijrah is of different categories. And this is a matter of agreement between the majority of the ulama. They have said, if you are not able to make your religion apparent. Now, what is hijrah? Hijrah is leaving one land for another land, either for the purpose of your religion or for the purpose of safety. Okay, that's the definition. Now, this definition now applies to the following scenarios. So the ulama have said, if you can't establish your religion, then you need to make hijrah. If you can't establish safety, then you must make hijrah. Then it becomes wajib. So I would say in certain Western countries, yes, it might even be wajib. They can't pray, they can't have jumu'ah, they can't wear hijab, they can't wear niqab, they can't establish salat al-eid, they can't do certain things. Then we will say, move from one place to another, even if it's within the same country, perhaps, if one location is better than the other for the purpose of their religion or for the purpose of their safety, then it becomes wajib for them to do so. This is the first category. The second category, those people who are able to establish their religion and they've got peace and security, even though if they were to migrate to another place, they'd be established in their religion even better, perhaps, or they'd be even more safer, perhaps. In this category, the ulama have said that it's mustahab for them, meaning it's recommended for them to make hijrah, but not wajib. And then you've got a third scenario where the person is not able at all. Not able. Even if he's not able to establish his religion, he's not able to move. then we will say that there is no hukm upon this person. إِلَّا الْمُسْتَلَأَفِينَ مِنَ الرِّجَالِ وَالنِّسَاءِ وَالْوِلْدَانِ لَا يَسْتَتِيُونَ هِيلَ وَلَا يَهْتَدُونَ سَبِيلًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala even makes an exception. He says those people who are weak from men, women and children, they had no way out. So then there is no harm or blame on these people. There's another actual category, which is mubah, and we find this in the hadith of al-a'mal, innama al-a'mal bin-niyyat. فَمَنْ كَانَ هِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ فَهِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَمَنْ كَانَ هِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى دُنْيَا يُسِيبُهَا أَوْ إِمْرَأَةٍ يَنْكِحُهَا فَهِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى مَا هَاجَرَ إِلَيْهِ. A person moves from Leicester to London for the purpose of employment. A person moves from London to Leicester for the purpose of marriage. All of these are mubah, because we are talking about exact sort of same when it comes to religion, and exact sort of same equality when it comes to their dunya. Now here, it's an usuli point here. This mas'ala when it comes to hijrah comes from the daruriyat al-khams. And we've talked about this before. If you've followed any of my previous explanations, you will know about the daruriyat al-khams. The daruriyat al-khams establishes a person's religion, their blood, their honor, their wealth, their lineage, their intellect. And these things the Sharia has come to preserve. So if a person can't preserve these things, then we will say you must go somewhere where you will have it preserved. Whether it's your deen, whether it's your dunya, whether it's your safety. But if you are able to go about establishing these daruriyat al-khams, even though there are sitta, even though there are six, then it becomes mustahab. And those people who are not able to, then la wujub ala ajz. Then there is no command upon a person who is not able to do something. So this is how the ulama have looked at it. There are different categories. So it's not that we can put everyone in one basket. And it's very important for us to understand that. Here, we're alhamdulillah, in the UK, I think we've got 2 million, maybe nearly 3 million Muslims. If we were to say to every single one of these people, and from them are the weak, from them are the disabled, from them are people who would want to do it, but they've got no prospects in said Muslim country. They wouldn't probably even be allowed in Muslim country. You've got people who are probably able to make that hijrah, but that could cause several repercussions which are negative when it comes to family and work and all those. So it's not fair for us to say, right, hijrah then becomes wajib upon every single Muslim. It's not correct, and this is not how the ulama have looked at it. But it remains, especially here, for I would say the Muslims here in Leicester, particularly, walillah alhamd, and certain parts of the UK, certain parts of the West, I would say, alhamdulillah, you are able to establish your religion. Perhaps, Allah knows best, you may be even able to establish your religion in a very Islamic way, more than had you done so, had you lived in a Muslim country. For wallahi, I've even seen people that moved from the UK to a Muslim country, and the iman actually got worse, and it regressed. So to conclude, not every situation is the same, and I would say that this is the way that the ulama have looked at it. If a person is thinking about it, then I think it's best for them to consult a person of knowledge. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He makes us of those who make hijrah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with our hearts before our bodies. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the best of return. Allahu a'lam wa sallallahu ala Muhammad.